Un šodien trīs burvīgi lektori, kas šīs nedēļas ietvaros seminārā strādā ar mūsu dalībniekiem, nodos šo ziņu arī visiem šeit interesantiem, klātesošajiem cilvēkiem. Par ko tad mēs runāsim? Mūsdienās, kad patērētāja kultūra piepras un rada jaunu audiovizuālu saturu, mirku, tā viņš šķiet, ka klusums un vizuālā tīrība ir kļūst par privilēģiju, kas pieejam tikai savrupiem vai īpaši bagātiem cilvēkiem. Šodien mēs pieskarsimies jautājumiem un elementiem, kas varētu apvienot skaču un vizuālo dizainu un veidot to patērētājiem draudzību. Tas ir arī šo radošo darbnīcu mērķis šīs nedēļas ietvaros, un šodien publiskajās lekcijās trīs lektori mazliet ievadīs, kā teikt, domu šajā virzienā, lai arī pārējiem, kuri nav šī semināra un praktisko darbnīcu dalībnieki, būtu zināms priekšstats par to, ko tad mēs šajā nedēļā esam darījuši un uz ko mēs ejam. Kā pirmo, no lektoriem es vēlos pieteikt Jāni Bērzemnieku, kurš ir radošais direktors un audio zīmolvedības konsultants Latvijas skaņu dizaineru asociācijas dibinātājs. Lūdzu, Jāni!
Labdien visiem! Tā kā tēmas uzdevums jau ir pieteikts, stāvēs ekrāni. Es atļaušos reiz izstāstīt, ka jums arī mazliet naivu un pasmaku stāstu. Tie, kuri no jums ir lasījuši Jāņa Joņeva novelu Jelgava 94 vai nesenā kārtā redzējuši kino filmu jaunovelu, kurš jūs būs vienkāršāk saprast. Un tā kā iztēloties to manu jaunības vizuālo estētību un tos skaņu saviņus, kas to laiku pavadīja. Principā man arī bija klases biedri, vienu viņi noteikti varētu savu nāvi vai zomis. Tā manā pirmā pieredze tāda audiovizuālo lietu sākās ar situāciju, kad man bija viens klases biedrs, kuram bija teicis, kuram bija profesionāla audio kaseša pārrakstīšanas un ierakstīšanas iekārā. Līdz vēl vai no citam klasbietam bija vecākais brālis, kurš spēlēja īstā grupā. Viņam par šitā laika bija vienkārši neticama milzīga kaseša kolekcija. Nu, tad mēs, protams, kā mazie panki, tā laika izglītīja par mūzikas pirātismu un kaut kādu cieņu, tad mākslu. Mums, prāt, ka labākā ideja bija vienkārši pārrakstīt visu tās kasetes. Tad audio un arī kurš tā perfekta autentiska, un mēs arī pārkupējam visus vizuālos vācības visām kastrupēm. Tā bija Nirvana, tā bija Radio, Pink Floyd, Muse, agrīnie ierakstiem. Tā arī bija tā mūzika, kas mums tajā laikā kļūva par mūsu izglītību un protesta laika soundtrackiem. Tad kaut kā tā interese mani nekad nepameta. Arī domāt ne tikai par to, kā kaut kas skan, jo tā mūzika man sāka vienkārši ietvaru vairāk, bet tur gājām iekšā savā mazajā burbulī, nezinu, dziļāk. Sāku spēlēt ģitāru, sāku taisīt garāžu grupas. Un paralēli tam visam es arī sāku zīmēt kasešu vāciņu dizainus savām grupīgi taisītajām mikstēm kasešu biznesēm. Sāku zīmēt logotipus, droši vien arī katrā matemātikas stundē uz visām plažu lapas pusstūriem. Un vispār arī tad sāk pievērst uzmanību, kā man viļāko grupu logotipu. Tā logotipa izstās, kā un vāciņa izskatās, un kā vai mūzikas video klipas saslēdzas ar to, kā es jūtu to mūziku, un kā es viņu iztēlojos. Dažreiz saslēdzās, dažreiz ļoti labi sakopējās. Es pat negribēju atrautās abas maņas, bet dažreiz lielākoties tomēr man kaut kāds vizuālās lietas traucē. Lūk, tad tā mani interese nav. Arī mani pamatus, ka arī Jānim Joņevam mums banāla līdzība precitāte arī, ka mani sauc Jānis. Mani stāsts droši vien var teikt, ka man notika 10 gadus vēlāk. Citā Ziemeļu Vidzemes pilsētā Smiltenē, savas Smiltenē 2004. Jānis arī viņš strādā reklāmā, es esmu nācis strādāt reklāmā, kas bija visam profesionāli laikam pret to patērēt kultūru un komerciju, bet tomēr reklāma tad ļoti labi vieta, kur strādā, ka viņi interesē komunikācijai, interesē, kā cilvēku pa īstenību, kā viņi domā, kā veidojas kāds kolektīvais viedoklis sabiedrībā un uzskatā. Lūk, un tad šie te mani padzītā interese par to, kā iedarbojas dažādas lietas komunikācijā uz cilvēku. Ja mani novedusi pie Latvijas skaņu dizaina rastādā dibināšanas kopā ar vairāk par latviešu neatkarīgiem skaņu dizaina producentiem un skaņu studijām. Tā ir tāda organizācija dibināta šogad, kur pēda, kā klusumā rodas sadzirdamais, kā iedarbojas cilvēku, un tad mēs viņu kopīgi domājam, kā par skaņu vajadzētu runāt, lai ieinteresētu, ka viņu kāds mums vajadzētu uzstrādāt. Lūk, turpmāk sadaļas būs sadalīta 5 daļās, kur es ceru, ka beigās mums katram būs kaut kāds savs uzskats, un būs tāds diezgan radikāls viedoklis par to, kā es to visu redzu kopā, jums to nav obligāti jāpiekrīt. Bet es ceru, ka jā, mums skatīsies kaut kāds savs jaunas idejas par to. Un šī brīža slaida tiks sadalīta kā divās daļās, priekš salīdzinājumu, un kontrasts vienmēr palīdz ieraudzīt kaut kāds atšķirīgās lietas, kā tā vizuālās identitātes un skaņu identitātes līdzīgas tā. Sāksim tādu visai populāru eksperimentu. Viena no šīm grafiskajām formām sauc skikiem, un otra forma sauc buba. Kuru grafisko formu sauc skikiem, kuru sauc buba? Variant? Nu, jūs paskatāties, kurš domā, ka kreisi ir buba? Viens cilvēks, kurš domā, ka kiki ir kreisi? Jā. Tad tik reizes, un ļoti daudz šis eksperiments ir veikts, tad parasti arī 98% no auditorijas atbild, ka kiki ir pa kreisi, pa labi buba. Kas ir tie 2%? Es nezinu, Nikolāv. Ko citādi uztvert pasauli. Ir teorija, ka tie 2% vienkārši tieši no autisma. Bet ja mēs turpinām, kā kolektīvi vienojamies, ka pa 98% mēs noticam tai teorijai, kas tāds varētu būt tāda lingvistiskā un vizuālās attiecības sinerģija. Tas arī, starp citu, ir ļoti sans eksperiments, viņš ir radies. Tāpēc pirmais simbolis, kas to novērā, bija tāds Wolfgang Kochlers, amerikāņu vācu psihologs, kurš to novērā 1929. Gadā. Nu, interesanti, ka pirmais eksperiments, kā pirmā fokusa grupa, bija spāņu valodu runājuši cilvēki. Pēc tam, ja par to vēlreiz dažādās citās fokusa grupās atklājās, ka faktiski tas tāds universālais eksperiments, ka tas darbos visām valodām. Nu, ja mēs noticam šeit teorijai, tad iedomājamies, varbūt var pacelt roku tie, kur ir grafiskie dizaineri, vai ir topošie grafiskie dizaineri. Ja tad iedomājieties, ka jums tiek iesūtīts uzdevums izstrādāt logotipu muzikālam ansamblim, kura mūzika izklausās šādi. Tad visi dizaina kritiķi, kā jums šķiet, ka šāds logotips būtu atbilstošs? Ok. Es nezinu, kā jums, bet es 2004. Gadā man šitā bija tāda top lieta. Kāds atcerās vēl? Jā. Kāds atcerās, tie jau man liekas cits paudzes ir. Un šeit arī ir tagad ir hip lieta, jā. Nu šeit arī, ja ņemot to buba, to ideju, tad kurš vien es arī nevarētu citā tā iedomāties to logotiku. Kuba buba lūkotam kantāņu fondu. Tad paturpinot par to, kā mēs vispār uztveram vizuālās lietas, lingvistiskas lietas, vai kaut kādu vārdu, mums jau fonētiski jau izskan galvā, mēs zinām, kā viņas skan, dažreiz izskatās, ir tāda interesanta psiholoģiska un bioloģiska lieta, tas ir tāda sinestēzija. Un tā praktiski tā kā tāda zinātne par to, ka samiksējas uz dažādas maņas. Un dažiem no cilvēkiem ir šāda tā lieta, kas gan jāzīmē, jo sinestēzija nav slimība, ir vienkārši tāds aspekts, kā cilvēki vienkārši piedzīves ir tādi, ko arī nevar attīstīt. Tas ir par to, ka piemēram visi mēs zinām, kā izskatās cipars 6, un mēs zinām, kā izskatās cipars 8, vai kā izskatās būtis 2. Bet ir daži cilvēki, kas dzirdot cipari 6 vai redzot 6, viņi uzreiz redz arī kādu krāsu. Tas ir tā kā spontāni, noteikti pilnīgi neapzināti. Ir būt kāds, kuram ir sinestēzija, vai neviens neatzīstās, vai nenojauši. Ir tāda, šeit ir tāds stils fenomens, ka praktiski, ja tevi sinestēzija, tev nenojauši, ka tā ir. Tā ir. Tu nevar iedomāties, ka citādā varētu būt, ja kāds tev nepasaka, ka hei, tev cik man gadā nav. kā liek domāt par to, ka mēs tomēr ticam tādā realitātē, kāda mums tiek prezentēta. Un statistiski skatās, tad mums tā rāda, ka vismaz viens no divas astoņiem cilvēkiem tomēr piemīt kaut kādu formas iestrējumus, formas ir dažādas. Kā tie ir apmēram 4-5% no visas populācijas šīs planētas šobrīd. Multi manis jau ierakstās mums visos, mums jau visam sajaucās manis. Līdz ar to, vai kāds ir, kurš nedzirdē viņš šo attēlu? Vai viņš šo attēlu? Vai ne? Vai kāds dzird šobrīd papiks laimes tam identitāti? Ir kāds, kurš zinu, kā skan? Neviens, jā? Nu, es arī nezinu, jo kopš 87. Gada laimā nav savas kā identitāti. Man ir bijis izdevība arī nekādām saģentūrā strādāt ar laimu. Es ļoti labi zinu, ka viņi ļoti skrupulos pievēršu vienībā grafiskas izēna, piešojumiem. Un vienmēr atpazīst krāsus, balts, šāds fonds, uz sarka fonu būs, iepakojums specifiski spēkā vienmēr atpazīst. Tad vēl profesionālu darbību nesaistīt, man bija tāda pa laimu un nelaimu iespēju dzīvot blaku šokolādes fabrikējums. Rīgā uz vienas palīdzības ielas stūri. Kad nu sākumās šis tāpēc forši, tā ka tu atver logu un vienmēr šokolādes smaiņu iebrāžu. Nu, padzīvojiet mēnesi un... Kad es ziņā tā arī bija tāds saskaisnes punkts, kas vienmēr atverot logus, tā ir laima. Iet veikalā, redzu, iepratu, tā ir laima. Žakuši arī nav skaņa, un arī varēja ļoti paspīt izmantot savu muzejā, savas veikalos, arī savās jaukajās kafēnīcās, kas ir veidots tieši tās šokolādes, kas tur bija arī jau stūrīši dāvi. Nu, cerams, kādreiz ir arī šādu aspektu apsvērš, varbūt ar šas prezentācijas, kas man no jums vai vairāk sāk apsvērt to sinerģību starp vizuālu momentām un skaņu. Jā, par ilūzijām praktiski mēs tikai arī runājam. Multi mani būtu, ka mēs esam visi skaidrs. Bet tomēr es atradās teikt, ka liela dzīve, liela daļa no mūsu dzīves sastāv no ilūzijām. Es teicu, mēs kaut ko redzam, mēs kaut ko dzirdam, mēs esam ļoti pārliecināti, ka tas ir tās. Un šeit jums atskaņojuši divas videoklipus. Un katrā no videoklipiem nemainīsies skaņu celiņš, mainīsies attēls. Tad mēģināt uzminēt, kurš bija īstais ieraksts, kurš atpilst reāli. Tā, ka viņam tika iedots austrums, kurā atskaņo tad panikā kliedzoši cilvēki vēlas, kad piesnāk zempā, kad ir tos, kad griezis. Uz brugatoļiem tiek rādīts divas formas, apas un kvadrātas. Katru reizi, kad parādās apas, ieskanās zaustiņām un ļaušanā. Lai tas būtu vēl tikai intensīvāk, viņam pie rokas tiek piesakrināts tāds neliels elektrošoks. Nav nāvējoši, bet vienkārši tāds sajust. Un tad skatāmies, kas viņš notiek. Nozīmē, ka kādām žanriskām lietām arī paši par to neatzina, nu, tā ir atzīmā. Šeit arī piemērs, es varu paņemt kaut kādu pilnīgi tādu nāju, nevainību ciesu no Adeles, hello, un vienkārši pastāvēs, kā viņi izskan dažādu žanros. Pavarot vienkārši, kā viņas liekams justies, vai tam tiešām ir jāpievērš uzmanību, vai tomēr ne.
Thank you.
varēja patikt, varēja nepatikt, tam nav mūsīgs. Tad ir, ka tā mana nobeiguma tēze, kuras pat jums atstāt, tas, ka tādā audiovizuālās sinerģijas kontekstā svarīgi ir tas, kā mēs pats reiz nopinīsim. Šeit mēs arī konkrēti ideja tādā izstrādā, visur, ka jūs ar šo uzņēmumu saskarties, visur būs ieturēt vienestētīgi. Man arī vēl jūs viņu asociēsiet. Tas, vai jums patīk tās, kā jau nepatīk, tam nav nozīmē sošķirīgi. Tā kā mēs cilvēku balsts sarašķiram, Liena ir tāda, Reina ir šāda. Nav obligāti jāpatīk šī cilvēka ceļai, īstenībā ne viņa balsīs. Mums ir jāatzīst, tas ir Reinas. Tādēļ tas ir mazāk svarīgi, jā, kā kaut kas izskatās vai kā kaut kas izklausās. Konsekvence ilgtermiņā ir daudz svarīgi. Līdz ar to arī, atcerot visu, ko es rādīju, tās ilūzijas un manipulācijas paņēmienas, ka tas varētu, tas ir pilnīgi pārliecināts, ka es varētu likt jums noticēt, ka šī ansambļa mūzika ir kopā. Tātad, ka šis te grupas lovedis būtu šāds. Kurš teica, ka ir rozā krāsa, nedēļ metāla? Jautājums, kā esmu nopinicējis. Un es jūs vienkārši ilgtermiņā par hipotizē trīs gadus pēc kārtas. Jūs vienkārši vienā brīdī sāksiet nopinicēt un identicē. Brīdī, kad jūs saskaties to grupu audio, jūs redzēsiet video, grafisko zīmi un otrā. Tā kā tā, ņemiet šo par labo, neņemiet, bet tā, tas bieži vien tomēr tā. Paldies!
Mazliet par audio ekoloģiju un skaņu saskarstu pastāstīs Andris Indāns, Latvijas elektroniskās mūzikas vecmeistars. Leģenda arī guru. Tāpat arī Gas Sound studio un dažādi interesanti skaņu izdevēši. Eksperimentālās mūzikas, kā jūs redzat, profesionāls. Vēl mazliet pāris sekundes tehniskajām niansēm. Vēlos tikai atgādināt, ka šī projekta ietvaros nedēļas garumā. Mēs šo lektoru vadībā esam strādājuši darba grupās, lai atklāt šo skanu un vizuālo elementu līdzās pastāvēšanu, ko mazliet jau Jānis jums parādīja, un vēl vairāk par skaņas ekoloģiju parādīs un arī pastāstīs, un jums liks arī to visu dzirdēt. Andris ar savu nākamo stāstījumu, vai mēs esam gatavi? Tikko arī atgādināt, ka darbu grupu rezultāti mums ir paredzami, ka būs sagaidāmi sestdien. Un sestdien notiks arī šo rezultātu prezentēšanu.
Labdien! Kā jau tika pieminēt, manā radošā un profesionālā darbība ir lielā mērā saistīta ar dažādiem trokšņiem. Es esmu mūziķis un dažkārt arī komponists, kurš ir radījis skaņdarbus, kas sastāv no ļoti nemuzikālām skaņām, no dažādiem trokšņiem. Un diezgan loģiski ir, ka es šodien pastāstīšu par skaņas ekoloģiju šajā sakarā, jo tā man ir tāda pazīstama sfēra, trokšņa izpēta un tā tālāk. Jā, es aizmirsu intro skaņu uzlikt. Mums jāsaskarās ar diezgan daudz dažādām konkurējošām skaņām, konkurējošiem signāliem, kas konkurē par uzmanību un, ir skaņu dizaineriem mūsdienā diezgan liels izaicinājums, kā to visu organizēt, lai vide kļūtu harmoniskāka. saprotam, un tā tālāk, kā es kā apklost, skaņas vidi nomainās, atsakot, katrs meklē to savu iespēju, savu veidu sazināties, dzirdēt viens otru. Vēl pie tā paša es gribēju pastāstīt par tā saucamo Lombarda efektu skaņā. Tas ir apmēram tāpat kā es tagad. Tas runāju skaļāk kā teiksim, mājās, lai man nāks izmainīt signālu un trokšņu attiecību, lai jūs dzirdētu manu balsi uz šīs nepārāk skaņu apsardējošās zāles akustikā. Tātad Lombarda efekts ir dažādi veidi, gan skaļums, gan balss kompresija, kā izcelt savu sakāmo. Un te ir interesants piemērs, kā Sixpads to dara, tad, kad tiek atskaņot baltais troksnis. Sākumā tas ir posmā. Par Lombarda efektu katrs ir visvairāk saskāries skaļā koncertā vai reivā. Kad, lai kaut ko pateiktu draugam, ir diezgan jāpaskaļīt savu balsu. Un tā tālāk, kas apsorbē, rezonējošo frekvenciju istabā, un mums kļūst komfortablāk gan sarunāties, gan klausīties mūziku. Jo nekvalitatīvāk skan mūsu balss, rezonējošāk un mūziku, jo mums vairāk nogūst smadzenes atvedējot šos skaņu signālus, mēs patērējam vairāk enerģiju. Nemaz nerunājot par stresu ilgstoši, klausoties kaut kādā tādā trokšņainā signālā. Par otrs ir sabiedriskās vietās. Es gribēju piemēru atskaņot vienā kafejnīcā Parīzē, kur es iegriezos diezgan agri no rīta. Nebija pat kā apmeklētāji, bet un kafejnīca bija tādā modernā minimālismu stilā, betona sienā. Un pat tukšā kafejnīcā ierakstāja dzirdams diezgan tāds komentīvs. Asas metāliskas nāžu dākšības skaņas, kāpēc man tas jādzird? Tās ir tās lietas, ko ir diezgan elementāri novērst. Tālāk pastāstīšu, kā. Ārējās vidas skaņas izolēšana, nu, tās ir piemēram dažādas skaņu barjeras pie automaģistrālēm, kas, protams, ne pilnībā, bet pazemina šo automaģistrāļu trokņa līmeni. Tālāk par konkrēti dažādiem veidiem skaņu slāpēšanas, ja trokņa slāpēšanas. Nu, pirmkārt, tā ir distance. Distancējoties no trokšņa otru, mēs to mazāk dzirdam. Tāpat laikā ir jāņem vērā, ka piemēram, ka zemfrekvenču līņu garums ir diezgan pamatīgs. Piemēram, ja jūs mājās savā istabā klausieties mūziku, ja, jums tas liek, piemēram, techno klausieties, un jums kājbunga liekas diezgan ok dzirdam. Bet kājbunga skan 40 Hz frekvencē un 40 Hz frekvences viļņa garums ir 12 metri. Tas nozīmē, ka jūsu istabā viņa mums līdz galam neizrazumē, bet kaut kur divas dzīvokļus tālāk ir tas punkts, kur skan viskaļāk, un kaimiņš nāk pie jums ciemos, viņam nu, nenormāls kaut kādi dunoņi. Viņš normāli pie manis, bet nu, ir šis jāņem ārā, jā, bet jo zemāk frekvenci, jo viņa garums ir lielāks. Tātad vēl mēs varam slāpēt istabā telpā un apsarbēt esošo rezonanciju ar dažādiem mīkstu materiālu, skaņu slāpēšanas materiāliem. Interesanti ir par konceptzālēm, piemēram, akustiskās konceptzālēs ir būtiski, lai akustika būtu tā, lai skaņa izskan. Tāpat laikā tur, kur elektroniskajā mūzikā un šādā lekciju formātā atkal ir šīs rezonējošās frekvences jāslāpē, lai būtu labāk sadzirdama runa. Piemēram, Rīgais pēdējos pāris gadus darbojos Tallinas ielas kvartālā, kur tie ir jaunieši aktīvisti, kas ieņem industriālas telpas no Free Rīgas, kur veido kultūras pasākumus un tos tarp arī lekcijas. Un kā jau tādās industriālās betona telpās, nekādas skatu slāpēšanās lietas nav iesaistītas. Nu, pirmais bija tas, ka kaimiņi zvanīja policijai no tā, ka tā pati kājpunga skan pa visu rajonu mežonīgi. Gluži vienkārši tāpēc, ka tādā tukšā garāžā pietiekoši skaļā atskaņoja, strādā tā garāža visu kā tāda tumba, ja nav piestrādāts pie skaļas izolācijas. Un tāpat ar lekcijām bija es biju aizgājis uz lekciju, tādā diezgan palielā kalpā, apmēram, kā šī. Un bez mikrofonu un tā. Un praktiski nekas nebija saprotams, jo pirmkārt vēl tā čabēšana un tās klusās sarunas veido to drošu līmeni. Otrkārt, diezgan liela reverberācija, tas ir nu, atbalsts. Tas ir būtiski, ja mēs kaut kāds, tāpat arī kafejnīcā, ja mēs sarunājamies, ir daudz ērtāk, ja mēs dzirdam kaut kādas valodas, verbālās nianses, nevis tos nažas un dakšiņas. Tā. Vēl ir gribēju sīkāk pastāstīt par tie pārsvarā augšā ir pasīvie skaņas slāpēšanas veidi, bet mūsdienās mēdz arī pielietot aktīvo trokšņu kontroli. Un tas ir, ka mikrofona tiek uztvērtā trokšņa signāls kaut kāds. Vislabāk tas tiek pielietots pie kaut kādām zemfrekvences dūmoņām, piemēram, kaut kādos industriālos rūpnīcās. Un šis drošņa avots signāls tiek izanalizēts, un 180 grādu pretfāzē tiek palaists tāds pats signāls un ar tādu pašu amplitūdu tikai pretfāzē. Un rezultātā drošņa līmenis samazinās esošais. Notiek, protams, pēdējos gados, vai pēdējās pāris dekādēs, veidot saucamās skaņas kartas un drošņa kartēšana, lai saprastu, kā kurā akustiskajā vidē, pilsētā vai ārpus pilsētas, kā izklausās, es domāju, ka arī Google Map drīz būs par šis skaņas celiņš katrai vietai. Un te, piemēram, ir Londonas karta, kur izvēlēties kādu apgabalu interesējošo. Var iepazīties ar to, kā tur skan, kāds troču līmenis un tā. Es droši vien esmu attiecis arī uz tevi. Ir diezgan daudz internetā darādas tās skaņas kartas pieejamas. Ir arī tādas, kur paši pievieno. Tēs šobrīd atvērt tādu Upperī or, un es tur atradu vienkārši arī, ka Liepājā ir pievienot dažu skaņas objekti. Tā intereses pēc aiziešu. Paklausīsimies, kas, ko mēs dzirdam Liepājā. Ko es gribēju kā konkursiņu izspēlēt par skaņu, kas asociējas ar Liepāju. Man tā ir varbūt nevis jūras skaņa, bet e-ģeneratora skaņa, ko es pirms diviem gadiem ierakstīju. Savu personīgo pieredzi, kas arī pastāstīs par to skaņas spēku. Es, piemēram, aizbraucu tepat uz to vēģenerātoru parku, un sekotnēji man ļoti iedvesmoja šī spēcīgā vibrācija mums, ķēra skaņas nianses dažādās vietās un tā. Un pēc minūtēm 20 šādas aktīvas darbības es jūtu, ka tā skaņas pieredze ir bijusi tik jaudīga un tā vibrācija tik spēcīga, ka es esmu pilnīgi bez spēka un ar sāpošu galvu. Es varu just līdzi tikai tiem, kas dzīvo netālu no šīm vēja turbīnu, lai ko arī neteiktu zaļās enerģijas aizstāvi. Vēl par skaņas ekoloģijas sakarā mēs varam runāt savā veidā arī par, es domāju, visiem zināmo skaļu un kāru, kad par kompresijas standartiem, kādi tie bija agrāk un kādi bija tie mūsdienās. Vai visi saprot, kas ir skaņas masterings un kompresija, respektīvi kompresija ir klusāko skaņu paskaļināšana tā, lai viss signāls kopumā skaļāks paliek. Un te mēs redzam skaņas viļņus no popmūzikas 83., 91. un 99. gadā. Un var sakot no tādas diezgan skaista tāda zīmējuma līdz tādiem klucim, kur viss ir tā kā novienādojies. Un tikai tagad, gan teiksim tāda mastering inženiera ētiskā tā sabiedriskā doma ir nonākums, ka ir sasniegts tas maksimums, ir jāmasterē un signāls jāspēlē jēdzīgāk tā, lai ir šī dinamiskā daudzpusība. Un tā. Arī interesanti skaņas ekoloģijas kontekstā parunāt par dažādu brīdinājumu signālu un tādu evolūciju. Un kadreiz tie signāli nebija nemaz tik daudz, un tad viņus veidoja iespaidīgus un skaļus un metāls. Griezīgos tembros, tie paši baznīcas zvani un pulksteņu zvani un tā. Un es uztaisīju tādu nelielu prezentāciju no pavisam nesenu laiku telefonu signāliem, kādus mēs gadus 2015 atpakaļ lietojām. Un vienkārši, lai atgādinātu, ka tie signāli ir kļuvuši daudz, nezinu, varētu teikt, maigāki vai ausītīgumāki paklausīties. Godībā tas ir trokšņa piesārņojums, ko es nevis slāpēju, bet izmantoju mākslinistiskiem mērķiem paskaidrot. Ar līdzīgu piegājienu es veidoju Katrīnas Neiburgas video instalācijai Venecijas mākslas bienālē skaņas pavadījumu, kur tēma bija par vīriešiem, kuri garāžās meistaro visādus brīnumainus tehniskus izstrādājumus, labo savas mašīnas, un tā vārtsakot tad raupja tēma. Un pavadījumā dziedāja vīru koris, atdalinot šīs skaņas ar trokļu piesārņojot.
And I am going to
walk
into the room.
industriālo dizaineru un dizaina konsultantu, inovātoru un lietotāju draudzības ekspertu Čārlzs Bušmanis, kurš pastāstīs par to, kāds ir dizains, kad viņš neizdodas, vai, kā viņš pats saka, facepalm dizains.
One thing we work with This is the way we work with every client. The first is, oh, who are you? But who are you, not only name and surname, but what are your passions in life? What motivates you to do what you do? Really get a hold of who you are. So we can work with you. Let's see, who are your clients? Whom you work with? But if you sell tables and chairs, then you have the clients, maybe the big shops and the users. You also go in the users. But maybe you're a state institution providing services. To whom you provide your services? Who are the people who are the most in contact with? Why do you do what you do? And most importantly, why do you do what you do in the way you do it? Does it make sense how you came to do it in such a way? Are there things under you should be aware of? Then, one thing we generally ask our clients is, what is your business model? What is your business case? Because we cannot help them develop a product or a service if we don't have an overall view of what is happening, because you might go just completely wrong. Prototyping, testing. Prototyping from low resolution to high resolution, testing on user, and then finally implementing the project together. Here's one of the projects we did in the company. That was one of the early projects. And it was a company called ZS Technologies, and they developed a fantastic microphone. Imagine you don't need that. Anything with a cable when you speak on the stage, you just have this small thing you click on your clothes and just walk around and speak. You don't need also this head microphone with battery pack you click behind that are a bit inconvenient, and you need to run backstage, get equipped before your speech or at the beginning. And if you go to the toilet and you forget to switch it off, you're screwed. So they developed that product and they came to us telling us, hey, everyone says our idea is fantastic, they are interested in the product, that we do a good job, but no one is buying it. So yeah guys, good, okay? So let's see what we can do together. So first thing, who are you? We're a company, we're passionate, we sound, and also what is classroom environment, public environment equipment. So they already had clients they were addressing them to, they had contact to. Why do you do what you do? So yeah, because we're tired of this microphone system. It doesn't work. And if you have a small space, a small room you want to equip, it's absolutely practical. So then we spoke with them about their business model. What was happening there, where could they eventually meet opportunities, and then research. First thing we did is try the product ourselves. Okay, pretending I'm a user, okay, basically on me, I manipulated it, was a plastic version of the product. I said, why are you making plastic? So it's cheap to mass produce. Okay. Tried, and then how to use your single central button on your microphone. Oh yeah, if you click three times, you have this. If you click two times, you have this. If you keep it pressed, it links it. And what are these two your volume buttons on the side? So mapping all these functions. And then simply start a role play, pretending to use the microphone. Okay, I have a microphone. I want to do this. How do I do it? Because ultimately, I don't see it. And we did that with a simple flowmaster, a simple pen with a permanent marker on, pretending to be a button and trying to manipulate it. I mean, prototyping does not have to be fancy. We just did not have a cardboard scissor, but a pen and a permanent marker, so we use it. And then we went, we understood part of the issues with manipulating the product, but then we went to the client, in the client context. And say, okay, we have that product, what do you think of it? And the general answer was, yeah, but you know, these people, they're going on stage, and this is
pretty visible microphone once it's on the jacket. We cannot have ugly things like this. So the aesthetics was something important in this case. So, from testing the product, generating experiences also required to test it. We have a cycle of roughly 70 to 80 prototypes. The first prototype was just marker with a permanent marker on. Then we have gradually more evolved prototype. That's not the prototype, but just a small part of it. Maybe green on the top. Maybe placement of elements on the electronics board inside. So step by step, we redesigned the product. We shipped also some version, where we shipped the early prototypes, functional prototypes, to Kazakhstan, Australia, and USA. Don't ask me why Kazakhstan, I still don't know to this day. Fairs. We presented the product in fairs. We got feedback from potential clients. So we were able to make adjustment in the product accordingly, the last small touches. And a lot of people wanted the golden version of the book, which was not at the beginning. And from there, they then also potential resellers who started passing order. Hey, can we have an OEM product? So a product where we stamp our brand on, and all of a sudden, some months later, after certification, the product was distributed in 96 countries where they had issues to make even one sale before. If you want to see the final version of the product, I'll invite you to go to the Teradesk Technology website. And then also, as designers, sometimes we have clients we see ahead. There's something we could do together. The goal is to have a strong stance. We do not share information from one client to another client. But we might help them all together. Try to contact this guy or try to contact the other. We see there's something we can do together that will not get the bus. And that is, they met another Latvian company, which is called Catchbox. And other products are intercompatible. This is another project. This is one of the first big projects I did in Latvia. It was together with Riga Technical University. And it's called RTU Design Factory. So that is the time. Riga Technical University contacted me and said, hey Charles, you're a designer, right? We're making this great prototyping center. We need a designer to make things beautiful there. But design beautiful products. Okay, great, I'm a designer. Okay, I'll join the team. But let's start to redefine the project from the very beginning, because I'm a designer. So, first thing we did is we looked in the possibilities and in why do we want that prototyping center. And the aim was to support research and innovation in the university. Okay, good. How do you do that? Do you really need a service to support the core business of your university, which is education and research? This is what everyone is supposed to do. So how about we do not do it ourselves, but we create a space where people can do that. But where people can do that together. So I'm not going to be the one designing the product. The students will be the designers. The researchers, they will come with their ideas, their projects. We will be able to get them in touch together. We create a safe space where you don't have to fight for who is going to pay for what part of the prototyping of the project, which are very common fights in university. So we have that neutral sandbox where people can come and play. Great idea. We are going to look for funds. So how do you start a project when you have an idea and you have zero funds? Enter is on the left. And this is where the project starts. So me, broken chair, broken table. There is no light in that room. And I just had a sign RTU Design Factory on the table. And people started to come. I mean, what are you doing here?
too crazy person. And so I could start to have a dialogue with the person in the building, with the student. Hey, who are you? What are you studying? What are your needs? How can we support that? Then, with the support of the rectorate in the university, they pushed faculty in the building to give us a space. So, you know, the faculty, yeah, okay, we're going to try to give them the worst possible space that is allowed for people to work in. So, we got the pagramic. So, we got it from the basement room. What was the reaction to that? Yeah, excellent. This is not the coolest space in the entire university. So we took over this room, started to bring some broken chairs, broken table, that by then we decided to fix because it was becoming a bit more permanent. We contacted a local company, my personal contact with, was Massporta. They could borrow us a 3D printer because we wanted a point to attract people and just to come and see. So at that point we had 3D printers, we started having students coming in. Okay, what do we need? We started having researchers, you know, design factory, laboratory, yeah, cool. And we made a nice sign on the door, the lab. Then we pretended to be the absolute coolest space in the university. Painted the walls in different color, to a different type of attitude and atmosphere. And then we listen again. Yeah, we wrote material that were really needed for people. First thing was a printer, A4, A3 printer, because students had to run on the other side of the campus. Okay, we bring it there, they pay for their copies, we can take the printer within here. Great. And then next thing we brought in was video cutting plotter, because we needed that to make door snacks. Faculties in the field needed it. Next thing we bring, large format cutter. Again, we're able to little by little get equipment with donations or budget increase. And then at some point, bingo, because of the work we did that, because of the way we're making the project evolve by the same people, we got €1.5 million. With this, we're able to get a better space, completely furnish it, to get laser printers, CNC equipment, etc. A coffee machine. A coffee machine is the single most important piece of equipment, because our goal is to create a sandbox for people to talk and speak together. So if you give them a coffee machine and a table where they can sit, things will start to happen. And things start to happen. Today they have roughly 1,000 square meters. In 2 years, from the left pictures to the from the left pictures, we have a new space. We have a lot of equipment that we're made. We have a lot of projects starting to happen in student groups. We even have the students who learn English design factory because he was speaking only Russian. But I'm still not speaking any Russian, and I really wanted to learn about 3D printing, etc. But the only resources we had for it to read or to practice or to interface were English. So little by little, he learned English. And by the end of 1 year spending here regularly, was able to teach people how to use the machines in English. So, yeah, a lot of small things, small victories. The order is what attitudes people were coming with. You know, I'm coming here because it's a safe space to experiment and my crazy ideas will be welcome. This is the beginning of the renovation. It was 2 years ago. And again, if you want to see the result, I think you have to experience it by yourself. Following this, I worked with university in redefining their student business incubators, their student business incubators. What does it mean to have a business incubator in the university? Don't start from scratch, because it still makes sense. Okay, it makes sense. Who would be potentially interested in coming? Okay, researchers are interested. Graduates are interested. Students are interested. community is interested as well. How do we make it a welcome space for people to work together? So we just changed the name, called it Idea Lab. Started to work with the same attitude that we had in a design factory, and that's been a quite successful incubator. This is the third project, the latest. It's called Design Laboratoria. It's for Session Design Laboratoria. And this is a project in cooperation with Tessis Municipality. That's also the reason why we moved to Tessis. And they approached us and said, hey, can you open a fab lab in the municipality as you already did in RT? And I look at them. No, it doesn't make sense. But what we see is that we already have parties there which have plans to do that. So maybe better support them with maybe some finance so they can open it faster. And then you have another school with possibilities. Better connect people there. What we see is a space for people to get consultants, to get support from a design standpoint to build their product, to build their experience, to build their services. And so this is how we open the school session design laboratory. And people coming there, we have various people. One of the group is teachers coming there with their students for introduction to design methodology, but not design as I make beautiful things, but design as I bring meaning. We have also startups, companies coming from male producers to hairdressers, and restaurants. And we also have the municipality with whom we work there. So, yeah, helping them to develop policies, providing feedback and inputs on any question they might have. So we're there to support all these activities. And it was taken a couple of weeks ago in space, because this is the actual space. Also host events where I have some company which will make a very, very prototype, as I mentioned before, not just permanent marker or cardboard, very good things in general to get understanding. Yep. This is another project we work on. It's a project with the Greek Design School. Another use case. We also work with large companies, helping them refining eventually internal processes. This was HR department of Dell. They distribute Apple, Samsung, and other products. The method we use has a name. It's called design thinking. Some of you might have heard of it, some not. But it revolves around the user. For whom are we designing? Who are they? What they need? And also working together with them, developing product policies. It's, yeah, a specific design attitude for it as well. So how to design work is how you approach people, how you communicate with people, and also how you communicate your product. And these are, again, the goal for a company, elevate business ideas and policy with design, and make design tools accessible to all. First, understand what you're doing. Think deeper, generate ideas. Prototype them. If you prototype a song, maybe you're just humming it. You're just making something with a piano, with whatever instrument, you want a chair, on a table, in your head. How does it work? Then you test it on people. How do they respond to that? How do they respond to school identity sound? How do they respond to that sound associated with an organization, with a movie, with a picture? Gradually, then deliver it. How do you convince people? How do you get people on board with you, to support you, to be with you, and implement it? We developed a tool for that, that we use ourselves. We did pretty much every project we do, but also for clients, for the design of the Design Thinking Toolkit, English version is printed. I'm going to get the first prints on this week. So, FaceTime design. In daily life, there are a lot of small things, of experiences, of designs. And I think, how come can it be that bad? And this is my first example. Have any idea what that is? It's me going to the dentist. It's a dental clinic. So you go to the dentist, you go to your doctor, they give you the anesthetics, and then they start looking in your mouth. Hey, stop. You need to go get a radio. Sounds okay? You go with your open mouth to the other side of the building to get a radio. And say, hey, stop. Here is a ticket. Now go downstairs, still with your mouth under anesthetics, partially open because you have something in it that keeps it open, to pay. So you go to pay for the radio, come back up, queue again, eventually you get your radio. Great, 15 minutes of my time wasted to pay for a dental radio. Then go back to the doctor, they do whatever they need with your teeth. Maybe they need a second radio, so you repeat the operation, so this time with open mouth. All the way, and finally you go down and you pay a second time. My experience as a user there is absolutely horrible. Why is it like this? The fact is, the people doing the radio is a different company than the dentist. And they figure it's easier not to coordinate things together, but just to have the client paying each company separately at a central cash counter. And we have a lot of examples like this. Oh yeah, because it is really interesting, you need to agree on the common form, what happens if client cheats, what happens if client goes somewhere else, what happens if you forget something. So better don't have any trouble with one another and have a client where you have very trouble. I changed the dental clinic, I'm not going there anymore. So I'd rather pay 5-10 euro more and not have to walk 50-100 meters open mouth under anesthetics because I need a radio and I need to pay downstairs first in the union. So this is one of the examples which can be solved if we look at the experience from the user standpoint. This is the other example. Do you recognize this? This is Comfort Klasse from Passagier Wilson in Latvia. So I have one day, I have to take a train from Celsius to Riga. And, well, I decided, let's see how Comfort Klasse is here in the train. It cost me 1.33 euro extra. I'm going to give it a try. I was the only I did it. What is interesting is here, you know where this door leads? The train mechanic in front of the train. And the train mechanic, actually, you hear apps that you have much more noise in their cabin than in the regular cabin. It's badly insulated. So this vacuum is much more noisy than the second class vacuum. First thing. Second thing, you know when they place Comfort Class in the front of the train, they did not probably consult with the train mechanics. Okay, what do you do when you drive the train? What is happening? I got 1.5 hours of Schlager music. 1.5 hours of Schlager music in and rail noise in Comfort Class in the Latvian train. Yeah. I mean, nice, just nice headrests, but no, I'm not paying for Schlager music in Comfort Class. So, yeah. After 1.5 hours of train, I can reload the electric socket. Yeah. You also have the regular trains. This is the type of train that are between Riga and Jelgava. So, I'm commuting once a week from Celsius
to be biodiversity in Riga. So I'm changing train in Central Station and I'm taking a train like this. I have to buy two tickets. Because no, you can't buy a ticket from point A to point B. You buy a ticket per train. It's the same company, it's the same rail network, and it even happened to me, it's the same control areas in the train plus. So, you go in that train, and should you have had the misfortune of drinking a coffee in the train on your way, not only you have no trash can in the train, but you have no toilet. I don't know if you see, but there, it's ERAF project, modernization project for train. If you have someone in office somewhere who thought, we're going to modernize our train wagon, bring brand new seats, and completely forgot that maybe passengers in the toilet. So, it's the issue with designing out of context, designing from an office for the field. And then there's another interesting point in this train. There are actually trash bins in this one. Yeah, because not in all trains you have trash bins. But the trash bins, they are here. Between these, the two chairs. In between the two chairs you have a dark blue surface. And the trash bin is painted in dark blue with no handle. It's just a metal box you can take out. So no one really knows there are trash bins in the train. So you always end up with people leaving trash on the seat. Not because they want to leave them on the seat, but because there are no trash bins. Okay, I'm putting it here, then I'll take it later when I get off the train. How many times did I forgot a cup of coffee or things there? So yeah, would you just go in the wagon and say, hey, I'm a passenger, what do I need to do? Okay, I'm drinking coffee, what do I do with the cup? What do I do after I drank the coffee? Maybe I need a toilet. And these wagons have toilets prior to reconstruction. Also, this I was able to apply that. And this is the last step of my train journey. Or the first, depending on the direction you're taking. It's a train station. It's a ticket office. Do you think that's open? I mean, lights off. Rails down, this store down, no light from inside, very small window is open, giving you the indication there is someone inside to whom you might purchase your ticket. So yeah, if you go there, if I were not living in Latvia, I would have had absolutely no idea I could purchase a ticket here. I would hope there's no station security that is just taking care of the barrier 100 meters away from here. That is a very common one. You know you're not supposed to smoke 10 meters from the entrance of a building, that's it. What do people do? They smoke in front of the building. Always. And I had a case while working at the Technical University, and they approached me. I was smoking back then. I was smoking, I think, 10, 15 meters from the building entrance, but still I was too close from the building side for them, for that person. But you know why I'm coming here? Because it's protected from the wind. That's it. And there's no problem, there are windows, etc. I spilled your cigarettes from the entrance. Okay, well, I'll take it. And as you know, as this person was also one of the person managing the building, you know, if you want me to move away more than 10 meters, but an ashtray, I'll go there like a sheep. I'd rather be near an ashtray. I mean, an ashtray is a magnet for smokers. I don't know if you noticed here, but you have an ashtray on the side of the building. You rarely have anyone smoking in front of the door of the entrance. Just create a better alternative and then people will start to use it. So yeah, the stickers will not work. The mesh tray, it works. And you know why they did not put an mesh tray? Because they could not figure out who would pay the person who would empty the ashtray.
And rather than seeing the person does not have to spend half an hour every day cleaning the cigarette butts. This is another example. Luckily, this mentality is changing. But four years ago, I was with an official delegation in the university, and I took a staircase that I never took before. I said, "Ah, staircase, renovated." I said, "Renovated? Yes. We only use it for official visits. The rest of the time, it's locked." And yeah. You could only use that staircase in the building when there was an official visit because it was a nice looking staircase. And students have to go all around and have all the trouble because of that. There's the same problem. They have bridges connecting buildings also on campus. The bridges are locked because, yeah, then we don't have to go all around to close it in the evening. And students, anyway, they don't have to go from one building to the other. I think if you build bridges, at least you should do this more than them. That's the last face palm design example. This is a museum in Tessis. It's a Tess Regala Bills Mosaics. That I visited, I think, 2 weeks ago. The exhibition design is a bit old, or old school exhibition design. But how do you get through this museum? There are no arrows, there are no hands. I got lost in the museum. I wanted to get out, it took me 10 minutes to find the exit. I could not find my way out of that museum. And we were not the only ones. Also, other tourists, other visitors there that asked us, "Sorry, do you know where the exit is?" So, I mean, if you're a supermarket, you want to get people to keep buying your stuff, it's good. If you're a museum where you want people to follow an exhibition route, you must have screwed up somewhere. But then there's this other exhibition also in Tessis. It's the Resistance Museum, where they speak about who were resisting Nazi occupation and Soviet occupation. And this one is actually really nicely designed. And it is less than 100 meters from that museum I showed you before. And I have a much smaller operating budget. And they play with one historical thing. So they keep the story of the world. They allow you to dig deeper. They have a clear path in, out. Where you don't necessarily need a lot of signaling inside. The story they tell, they are clear. You have a focus point in the museum. If you go here, it's very confusing because you have a relation between one is on the right and one on the left. You're just jumping back and forth all the time. Here, again, okay, 1, 2, 3. This is what I want to tell you. If you want to go deeper, here you have access to more information. So if you go to Tessis, that's a place I would recommend you to visit. This is another example. It's a library that was built in Helsinki. And the budget to build the library per inhabitant is the same than they have for the Latvian National Library. So what happened there is they thought, okay, well, we built the library. What does it mean to be a library today? Do we only need books? Okay, we are a vector of culture. What is the culture today? How can we anticipate tomorrow's culture? How can we keep this role of the library as a community center of a sort, as a center of knowledge, as a center of sharing? So, yeah. Let's have room with PlayStation. Let's have room with gaming computers where people can come. Let's have 3D printers. They have sewing machines also. So you can bring your mobile phones and learn to repair them. Or you can do things there. And they have a lot of bookstores. You can borrow e-book reader, tablets, and a lot of things like this. So yeah, it's supposed to be what I learned today. Starting to make a new library is okay, it's a building for books, so I'm making a series of things yourself. But they're thinking, okay, starting again, asking yourself the obvious. I think being a designer is a lot about this attitude. Not be afraid to ask yourself the obvious. Does it make sense to be still with this? Why is it library today? Be open, listen to people, be flexible, be elastic. Yeah. I have a project, I literally went knocking on doors and asked people if I could sleep over. Reason being, the commission was to develop a project to create a community in the neighborhood. I accidentally ended up being the project, that's a different story, but I went to people and I knocked on doors, hey, can I come here? Can I share the Swiss formula with you? If I'm Swiss, I have to share also with myself, because I want to learn to know you, I want to know who you are. MRTs, and from there being able to build something for the community. Remarks, comments, objections? Okay, if you want more about this this design thinking toolkit, we have it on our website, designdomachana.com, English version. Okay, love it.
Paldies arī visiem klātesošiem, kas bija šeit kopā ar mums un uzzināja vairāk par dizainu, par skaņu, par vizuālo komunikāciju un par to, kā būt lietotājiem un draudzīgākiem. Tāpat arī mazliet par dizainu, kurš var arī neizdoties. Milzīgs paldies vēlreiz visiem trim lektoriem, kas bija šodien kopā ar jums. Paldies jums un tiekamies citām mūsu pasākumā.